see very significant societal changes. Probably one of the most significant, and one that is increasingly concerning people today, is the rise of artificial intelligence. In short, I believe that the rise of powerful AI will be either the best thing, or the worst, ever to happen to humanity. I have to say now, that we do not yet know which. But we should do all we can to ensure that its future development benefits us and our environment. We have no other option. I see the development of AI as a threat with its own problems that we know must be dealt with now and into the future. The progress in AI research and development is swift. And perhaps we should all stop for a moment and focus our research not only on making AI more capable, but on maximizing its societal benefit. Such considerations motivated the American Association for Artificial Intelligence, 2008 to 2009, Presidential Panel on Long-Term AI Futures, which up to recently had focused largely on techniques that are neutral with respect to purpose. But our AI systems must do what we want them to do. Interdisciplinary research can be a way forward, ranging from economics, law, and philosophy, to computer security, formal methods, and of course various branches of AI itself. Everything that civilization has to offer is a product of human intelligence, and I believe there is no real difference between what can be achieved by a biological brain and what can be achieved by a computer. It therefore follows that computers can, in theory, emulate human intelligence and exceed it. But we don't know. So we cannot know if we will be infinitely helped by AI, or ignored by it and sidelined, or conceivably destroyed by it. Indeed, we have concerns that clever machines will be capable of undertaking work currently done by humans, and swiftly destroy millions of jobs. While primitive forms of artificial intelligence developed so far have proved very useful, I fear the consequences of creating something that can match or surpass humans. AI would take off on its own and redesign itself at an ever-increasing rate. Humans, who are limited by slow biological evolution, couldn't compete and would be superseded. It will bring great disruption to our economy. And in the future, AI could develop a will of its own, a will that is in conflict with ours. Although I am well known as an optimist regarding the human race, others believe that humans can command the rate of technology for a decently long time, and that the potential of AI to solve many of the world's problems will be realized. I am not so sure. In January 2015, I, along with the technological entrepreneur Elon Musk and many other AI experts, signed an open letter on artificial intelligence, calling for serious research on its impact on society. In the past, Elon Musk has warned that superhuman artificial intelligence is possible of providing incalculable benefits, but if deployed incautiously, will have an adverse effect on the human race. He and I sit on the Scientific Advisory Board for the Future of Life Institute, an organization working to mitigate existential risks facing humanity, and which drafted the open letter. This call for concrete research on how we could prevent potential problems, while also reaping the potential benefits AI offers us, and is designed to get AI researchers and developers to pay more attention to AI safety. In addition, for policymakers and the general public, The letter is meant to be informative, but not alarmist. We think it is very important that everybody knows that AI researchers are seriously thinking about these concerns and ethical issues. For example, AI has the potential to eradicate disease and poverty, but researchers must work to create AI that can be controlled. The four-paragraph letter, titled Research Priorities for Robust and Beneficial Artificial Intelligence, an open letter, lays out detailed research priorities in the accompanying 12-page document. For the last 20 years or so, AI has been focused on the problems surrounding the construction of intelligent agents, systems that perceive and act in some environment. In this context, intelligence is related to statistical and economic notions of rationality. Colloquially, the ability to make good decisions, plans, or inferences. As a result of this recent work, there has been a large degree of integration and cross-fertilization among AI, machine learning, statistics, control theory, neuroscience, and other fields. The establishment of shared theoretical frameworks, combined with the availability of data and processing power, has yielded remarkable successes in various component tasks, such as speech recognition, image classification, autonomous vehicles, machine translation, leg locomotion, and question answering systems. As development in these areas and others moves from laboratory research to economically valuable technologies, a virtuous cycle evolves, whereby even small improvements in performance are worth large sums of money, prompting further and greater investments in research. There is now a broad consensus that AI research is progressing steadily, and that its impact on society is likely to increase. The potential benefits are huge, since everything that civilization has to offer is a product of human intelligence. We cannot predict what we might achieve when this intelligence is magnified by the tools AI may provide. But, and as I have said, the eradication of disease and poverty is not unfathomable. Because of the great potential of AI, it is important to research how to reap its benefits while avoiding potential pitfalls. Artificial intelligence research is now progressing rapidly, and this research can be discussed as short-term and long-term. Some short-term concerns relate to autonomous vehicles, from civilian drones and self-driving cars. For example, a self-driving car may, in an emergency, have to decide between a small risk of a major accident and a large probability of a small accident. Other concerns relate to lethal intelligent autonomous weapons. Should they be banned? If so, how should autonomy be precisely defined? If not, how should culpability for any misuse or malfunction be apportioned? Other issues include privacy concerns, as AI becomes increasingly able to interpret large surveillance datasets, and how to best manage the economic impact of jobs displaced by AI. Long-term concerns, comprised primarily of the potential loss of control of AI systems via the rise of superintelligences that do not act in accordance with human wishes, and that such powerful systems will threaten humanity. Are such dystopic outcomes possible? If so, how might these situations arise? What kind of investments in research should be made to better understand and to address the possibility of the rise of a dangerous superintelligence, or the occurrence of an intelligence explosion? Existing tools for harnessing AI, such as reinforcement learning, and simple utility functions, are inadequate to solve this. Therefore, more research is necessary to find and validate a robust solution to the control problem. Recent landmarks, such as the self-driving cars already mentioned, or a computer winning at the game of Go, are signs of what is to come. Enormous levels of investment are pouring into this technology. The achievements we have seen so far will surely pale against what the coming decades will bring, and we cannot predict what we might achieve when our own minds are amplified by AI. Perhaps with the tools of this new technological revolution, we will be able to undo some of the damage done to the natural world by the last one, industrialization. Every aspect of our lives will be transformed. In short, success in creating AI could be the biggest event in the history of our civilization. But it could also be the last, unless we learn how to avoid the risks. I have said in the past that the development of full AI could spell the end of the human race, such as the ultimate use of powerful autonomous weapons. Earlier this year, I, along with other international scientists, supported the United Nations Convention to negotiate a ban on nuclear weapons. We await the outcome with nervous anticipation. Currently, 9 nuclear powers have access to roughly 14,000 nuclear weapons, any one of which can obliterate cities, contaminate wide swathes of land with radioactive fallout, and the most horrible hazard of all, cause a nuclear-induced winter, in which the fires and smoke might trigger a global mini ice age. The result is a complete collapse of the global food system, an apocalyptic unrest, potentially killing most people on Earth. We scientists bear a special responsibility for nuclear weapons, since it was scientists who invented them and discovered that their effects are even more horrific than first thought. At this stage, I may have possibly frightened you all here today with talk of doom. I apologize. But it is important that you, as attendees to today's conference, recognize the position you hold in influencing future research and development of today's technology. I believe that we join together to call for support of international treaties or signing letters presented to individual governmental powers. Technology leaders and scientists are doing what they can to obviate the rise of uncontrollable AI. In October last year, I opened a new center in Cambridge, England, which will attempt to tackle some of the open-ended questions raised by the rapid pace of development in AI research. The Laverdium Center for the Future of Intelligence is a multidisciplinary institute dedicated to researching the future of intelligence as crucial to the future of our civilization and our species. We spent a great deal of time studying history, which, let's face it, is mostly the history of stupidity. So it's a welcome change that people are studying instead the future of intelligence. We are aware of the potential dangers, but I am at heart an optimist and believe that the potential benefits of creating intelligence are huge. Perhaps with the tools of this new technological revolution, we will be able to undo some of the damage done to the natural world by industrialization. Every aspect of our lives will be transformed. My colleague at the Institute, Hugh Price, has acknowledged that the center came about partially as a result of the university's Center for Existential Risk. that Institute examines a wider range of potential problems for humanity, while the Laverneum Center has a more narrow focus. Recent developments in the advancement of AI include a call by the European Parliament for drafting a set of regulations to govern the use and creation of robots and AI. Somewhat surprisingly, this includes a form of electronic personhood to ensure the rights and responsibilities for the most capable and advanced AI. A European Parliament spokesman has commented that as a growing number of areas in our daily lives are increasingly affected by robots, we need to ensure that robots are, and will remain, in the service of humans. The report as presented to MEPs makes it clear that it believes the world is on the cusp of a new industrial robot revolution. It examines whether or not providing legal rights for robots as electronic persons, on a par with the legal definition of corporate personhood, would be permissible. But stresses that at all times, researchers and designers should ensure all robotic design incorporates a kill switch. This didn't help the scientists on board the spaceship with HAL, the malfunctioning robotic computer in Kubrick's 2001, A Space Odyssey, but that was fiction. We deal with fact. Lorna Brazil, a partner at the multinational law firm Osborne Clark, says in the report that we don't give whales and gorillas personhood, so there is no need to jump at robotic personhood. But the awareness is there. The report acknowledges the possibility that within the space of a few decades, AI could surpass human intellectual capacity and challenge the human-robot relationship. Finally, the report calls for the creation of a European agency for robotics and AI that can provide technical, ethical, and regulatory expertise. If MEPs vote in favor of legislation, the report will go to the European Commission, which has 3 months to decide what legislative steps it will take. We too have a role to play in making sure the next generation has not just the opportunity, but the determination to engage fully with the study of science at an early level, so that they can go on to fulfill their potential and create a better world for the whole human race. This is what I meant when I was talking to you just now about the importance of learning in education. We need to take this beyond a theoretical discussion of how things should be and take action to make sure they have the opportunity to get on board. We stand on the threshold of a brave new world. It is an exciting, if precarious, place to be, and you are the pioneers. I wish you well. Thank you for listening.